It is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Robert Cochrane, who's our ringleader for today. So take it away, Robert.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody, for being here. This is exciting. And I'm going to jump right into the PowerPoint, which will guide most of what we're going to do for the first 45 minutes or so. And I have several students from the current class that we're running who will be sharing some of their stories along the way. And then we'll have some time at the end where we're going to open up for questions and answers. In the meantime, yes, again, please use that chat to respond to some various things that I'll be throwing throughout. But I want you guys to all know you're very actively part of this, and this is going to be a fun and interactive session. So here comes that PowerPoint, as I mentioned, and the first thing you're going to see on here is the title of what we're talking about, which is The Parkinson's Prison and the Hero's Journey to Escape. Oh, wait, that stopped. You know, it wouldn't be a good Zoom meeting if something didn't technically go wrong right off the bat. I know what that is. I used the wrong browser. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put that in the Firefox browser. So the name of the presentation, just so you know, again, is The Parkinson's Prison and the Hero's Journey to Escape. We will define it in all the fun terms that come forward. So no worries about that. You're also going to see on there that, yes, officially, PhD, I've got that title. That is in something called interdisciplinary health sciences. What that means, basically, what we study in that frame is we take on difficult, complex health challenges in a non-traditional way. We look at them through various lenses. In this case, we're looking at improvisation and storytelling's effect on Parkinson's disease, a complex disease, as we all know here. And then finally, what you'll see here is that Yes and Exercise is the name of the nonprofit that I've formed out of this process. I graduated last December, yay, and I broke out of that prison. And that's a whole other story called my DIY MF PhD story for another time. For right now, what I want you all to do is recognize that we're in this together. And one of the ways we get together is by listening to a little bit of music. I'm going to put this song on for about a minute. It is a song that is absolutely fitting for where we are right now, because if we're in prison, there's one thing we want. We want to break out, and that means we need freedom. So feel free to move, either sitting or standing. We're going to have about a minute of music. Here we go, to John Batiste, Freedom. Let's go. I promised you, I'm leaving it right now with you. Saw some quotes right there. There's some people like Brene Brown and Joseph Campbell and Viktor Frankl. They lead us through this process of this Parkinson's prison. And we're going to be talking all about them as we learn to storytell together. So as promised, I'm going to give you not more music at the moment, but I'm going to give you the definitions of our terms. And here's where we're going to go. You need a map if you're going to move forward. So in today's journey, we're going to define the Parkinson's prison. We're going to get this Sherpa's crazy idea. I mean, what the heck are we going to do with these improvisational storytelling elements? And what do they have to do with Parkinson's? We're going to attach ourselves to something bigger than ourselves, recognize some of our potential. We're going to then raise the stakes that this isn't just, oh, some, I think I'll do it maybe some other day. No, this is right now. And this has to matter in a big way. We're going to learn to become heroic and see our heroes mythologize themselves, become more than what they thought they could be. We'll learn to improvise because life doesn't always go the way we think it's going to. And we're going to play with our emotions, that in fact, those emotions are there to act as signposts for us. They can be great, great teachers to us if we allow ourselves to understand them rather than be hijacked by them. And then we're going to understand the power and the challenges of storytelling. It sounds great. However, it isn't just as easy as saying, I'm going to tell my story. not if we're going to tell an effective story that changes our own version of what goes on and perhaps changes the hearts and minds of others. And our goal is to break you out of your Parkinson's prisons. Now, what is the Parkinson's prison? Well, it's any mindset that a person uses, consciously or not, to limit themselves, okay? And that is, we can hear that when we hear things like, I can't, I shouldn't, I'm stuck because. And these can happen anytime, and we could totally be unaware of them. We may not know that we're putting these self-imposed limitations forward. There's this term called homeostasis, and maybe you've heard of it. It's actually an amazing function that our body has to normalize while changes are going on. And this helps us keep going, to not become overwhelmed. And while it's a wonderful function of our body, it can become corrupted in a chronic state of pain or illness or mindset that we can normalize things that are difficult or perhaps unhealthy. And then we start telling ourselves stories that are damaging, further imprisoning ourselves. So how will we escape? Well, number one, we must connect both to ourselves and through others. And there's that phrase, yes, and. It's going to play a big part in how we do it. We have to accept the circumstance. Yes, in this case, Parkinson's is part of my life. And here's what I'm going to do because of it. Okay. So this is where we're going to learn how to put those together. We're going to be courageous in exploring our story. And the definition of courage we're talking about here is vulnerability, right? We have to expose those parts of ourselves that maybe scare ourselves too. And we're going to be in a safe and brave space to do that together. And that courage is knowing that it's scary and we do it anyway. We're also going to listen and respond to others' stories, because if the only story that mattered was our own, we'd once again be in prison. So we have to open ourselves up to other people's stories, comment, share, feel with them empathetically, compassionately, in order to free ourselves. And again, we learn how to do that by working and playing together and building an ensemble. So that all is part of our process. So here it comes, the bold opening statement. You guys ready for this? Storytelling and improv can help find a cure for Parkinson's disease. Now, if that just blew you away, take a moment, take a breath. It's a bold opening statement. There's only one problem. It's impossible. Oh, everybody say it with me. Wah, wah. Well, here's the thing. That's the story we're telling ourselves, okay? Maybe there's a way that we can break through that impossible. And we'll talk about some of that as we go forward. So let me give you a little of my backstory and why I'm doing this. Well, why me? My dad was diagnosed in 2001, and we did this thing called Boys of Summer. And the Boys of Summer was a 2-month, 20,000 mile road trip to see all 30 major league ballparks together. There we are at the Field of Dreams. And at this time, dad's symptoms were relatively mild, and we were just figuring out what Parkinson's was for us. And we thought, okay, you know, a cure within 10 years. That was a story that leaders in Parkinson's field were telling us. By 2014, we knew that wasn't there because it was 10 years later and there was no cure. So we shifted to this idea of quality of life. And we moved forward with that. And we continued to tell the stories of what it meant to live with quality of life, to the point where 2 years ago, we went back to the Field of Dreams. And here we are again, about 20 years later. And dad recognized at this point that, you know what, despite the challenges of Parkinson's, I can still get out there and swing a bat. He went out there and hit the ball a few times, surprise us all. Forget the walker, he's out there cracking a thing. And he continues to challenge himself and define what's possible. Now, one thing my dad loved, always loved, was running. Parkinson's over the years has taken that away from him. And when I moved up to be closer to him about 2 years ago, I knew about this run he loved doing called the Beta Breakers here in San Francisco. You may know it's a 7.6 mile run, been going on for over 100 years, and it features a really steep hill called the Hay Street Hill. Well, as I was training for that, I noticed a son pushing his father in a running chair. And I said, it would be impossible for dad to run this, but what if I got one of those running chairs? Could a son push his father? Well, the answer is yes, and. Here we are at the top of the Hay Street Hill. You see those other people walking? We were running, okay? So we did that together. And it showed dad once again that he could participate. And we thought, well, that's great. That's enough. That's really what we're going to be about? Well, thanks to some friends, including our good friend Kevin Murray, who's here with us on the call, we got a hold of some friends with the Michael J. Fox Foundation. And you know what they said? They said, we love your story. We'd like to yes and it. How would you like to come to Disney World and run the Walt Disney World Marathon? Now, what they said actually was, you can do the 5K, the 10K, the half marathon, or the full. I didn't get that description out of my mouth before Dad said, let's run the full. So sure enough, we did. There we are at Disney World, 6 months later, doing something I'd never done before. I'd done half marathons, but never a full, while finishing my PhD. But you see the look on my dad's face? Sometimes that smile feels impossible, but that smile was so real. And the cheers he got as we ran that race were unbelievable. And again, a dream come true, far beyond wishes, some Disney magic. And it really starts with us saying yes and to what's possible. So I said, why me? Now I'm going to ask, why you? And what I'd like you to do in that chat section is go ahead and write who you are, the why you, as it were. Are you a person with Parkinson? You can put PWP. Are you a care partner? Maybe you put CP. Maybe you're a wellness or medical person who provides care for the person with Parkinson's. Go ahead and put that into the chat just so we get an idea of what your role is within this space. All right. Because that's going to determine, by the way, it's not just the people with Parkinson's who are telling their stories about Parkinson's. It is the care partners, the family members, the loved ones. It is the wellness and medical practitioners. We're all shaping the reality of what Parkinson's is. So it's important we know our stories. Now, how do we make the impossible possible? Well, one thing I mentioned was attaching ourselves to something bigger than ourselves. If you've heard of or read this book, go ahead and put yes in the chat. We'd love to see a whole bunch of yeses right now. Have you heard of or read Ending Parkinson's Disease? If you haven't, please do. I'm going to tell you a little about it right now, because what these doctors are proposing is a pretty big deal. Number one, they are sure to tell us that Parkinson's is the fastest growing neurodegenerative disease in the world. That puts the stakes in why we need to tell our story. The prevalence rates are equitable to what would be considered a pandemic. We doubled from 1990 to 2015. We're going to double the amount of people diagnosed by 2040 if we don't do something about it. And the prevalence rates also correlate with man-made chemicals, meaning that, hey, if we get these chemicals out, as they have done in some countries, we could lower the prevalence rates so we could at least stop getting people diagnosed and focus on the cure. Okay. The journey to the cure begins by cutting the prevalence. We need to stop how many people are getting diagnosed. That means getting those chemicals out. And they need stories, because they have the evidence, but that's not enough to change people's minds. So when it comes to impossible stories like finding a cure for Parkinson's, I want to remind you of a few others that you may have heard of. How many have heard of Erin Brockovich? You can raise your hand or say yes. It was impossible that she was going to get PG&E to pay up and admit that they had done wrong with their environmental polluting, but she did. How many have heard of big nicotine and big tobacco and their battle in the late 90s, right? To say nicotine is addictive. They were never gonna say that. That was impossible, yet it happened. Mothers Against Drunk Driving. It was impossible that people were gonna start wearing seatbelts, if that was gonna be a federal law, that they were going to get that to, in fact, make drunk driving a federal law. They did. All of these things happened because of storytelling. People told their stories loud enough and importantly enough from their hearts with courage and vulnerability to make the changes possible. This is whole stories versus I'm fine stories. How many people know, and you can either raise your hand or put yes in there to this, a whole story versus an I'm fine story. And I'm fine story is when people ask you how you're doing. Yeah, I'm fine. And that's the story you tell to protect yourself. Do you know that one? Yeah, I see some hands being raised. You know that one. The whole story can be, I'm really struggling. And guess what? I'm doing it anyway. I'm going anyway. That's the whole story. I'm really struggling and today's a horrible day. Or you know what? Today's an awesome day. I forgot I even had Parkinson's. That's the whole story. But if we don't tell the whole story, if we only tell the champion stories, for example, then we may think that Parkinson's isn't as much of a struggle as it is for some people. And there's more to it than that. What I'd like to do right now is invite one of my students up to join us. Her name is Doris Martin. And Doris has written a piece where it was at the approach to the inmost cave about 7 or 8 clicks into the hero's journey. And this is where she felt she was going to face her big ordeal. So if Doris is available, do we have her here? I want to make sure, first of all. We do. There's Doris. Everyone say hi, Doris. Hi, Doris. Doris, I'd like to invite you to please read your story.
Well, we had you and then you, there you go, Doris.
There we go. Okay, we got it now?
We got it. You're ready. Go ahead, my friend.
Okay, my paper is Approach to the Inmost Cave. And it begins with a quote from the 1976 film Network. I'm as mad as hell and I'm not going to take this anymore. This is what I tell myself each time I try to approach the cave. And how many times have I tried? Was it 116? There were times when I would be close and then some unforeseen event would derail the mission. Yes, all were valid events and I was still on the outside, apparently unwilling to face myself and move forward. Perhaps I am afraid, wallowing in the fear of the unknown. Fatigue, just too tired, depression. Perhaps I'm not clear enough about the mission. So let me do that now. Let me clarify that now. I want to heal my spirit, heal my body, keep my brain occupied in creative and positive pursuits, lighten up and play, and move solidly into gratitude and take joy in Leonard Cohen's line, ringing the bells that still can ring. If I were to accomplish this mission, would I be able to break out of Parkinson's prison? I firmly declare that to be true. So why am I mad? At about the 10-year diagnosis point, I threw a tantrum worthy of a 2-year-old. My anger is directed at the medical community. For 10 years, I've been over the top diligent with exercise, diet, and stress reduction because I was told these would all contribute to slowing down PD. I made it to 10 years, dancing as fast as I could. I did my part. It doesn't feel like they have done theirs. So boy, did I show them, all but stopping exercise and indulging in my favorite ice cream. Have I not learned in my 78 years that my attempt to punish the medical community was only hurting me? Why is it that our two best options for treatment are a drug called levodopa, first developed over 50 years ago and recently repackaged into a controlled release capsule, costing up to maybe 57 times the generic, of course. It's as if they have put thoroughbred racing colors on a mule and entered it in the Kentucky Derby, thinking we won't notice. Oh, and the other option, deep brain surgery. I'm neither a candidate nor desirous of this option. Perhaps we would receive a bigger portion of the resource pie if PD was a bit sexier. The dyskinesia dance that you see me doing right now is not nearly so appealing as the cancer in remission model, gorgeous woman, dramatically ripping off her wig to reveal a perfectly shaped, perfectly beautiful bald head. By the way, I want to be perfectly clear that I'm happy she's in remission, definitely. The point is just that hers is a more easy on the eyes look. It's a better optics. And many people seem to be put off by our involuntary movements, almost like they're afraid they're going to catch it. I feel like those of us in the 10 to 15 to 20 year diagnosis category are an embarrassment to the PD medical community. They have very little to offer and kind of really don't know what to do with us. In years gone by, we would probably be dead by now, but they and we have developed ways to manage our symptoms that keep us out of the sitting in the wheelchair drooling stage for longer periods of time. Another aspect of my prison sentence is the feedback I receive. You're doing better than anyone I know who has PD. How do you find the discipline to exercise every day? Your attitude is terrific. You're handling it really well. So I couldn't show anger without losing my reputation as someone who brings dignity to an undignified condition. Didn't want to lose all that positive attention either. So no one ever caught a glimpse of the middle of the night terrors in fear that I might have lost so much ground that I can't recover, and that I am racing towards being either warehoused or the grave. Thank you.
Doris Martin, can we please get a big round of applause for that beautiful story? Complex, fascinating, self-effacing, humorous, and calling out at the highest levels. This is the type of storytelling I'm talking about. I was deeply moved, and Doris, that you came to read that in front of everybody means the world to me, and I think everybody here too. So beautifully done, Doris, okay? We're going to keep going because we have more stories to share, and again, recognize that these are the things that come out of the process. That wasn't on the top of Doris's mind. These were things that through working the hero's journey in our group together, she was able to recognize and bring together and coalesce in such a beautiful way. Well done, Doris. All right, so the next level we're going to look at right here is the problem with the perception of Parkinson's, and really Doris spoke to some of them right there. One of the authors of Ending Parkinson's says, well, the Parkinson's community is too nice, Dr. Ray Dorsey says. What he means by that is we're not speaking up enough. Remember those other people, Aaron Brockovich could have been seen as not very nice, right? She knew what she needed. The Mothers Against Drunk Driving might have been seen as not very nice, just as the whistleblowers against Big Tobacco might have been seen as not very nice. Well, they were doing what they needed to make the change happen. And there's misaligned stories of Parkinson's disease. And again, Doris touched on some of them right there. But some people will say, and even people with Parkinson's will say, oh, it's not that bad. Maybe out of shame or guilt. Or they'll say, oh, you look great. And that might be either for the person seeing them, either ignorance because they don't know the whole story, or masking on the part of the person with Parkinson's. Or maybe they'll say, well, isn't it only older people? As if there was a pitiful statement. And number one, what if it was only older people? So what? Still terrible. Number two, it isn't. We know the prevalence rates in the young onset communities are rising too. There's a lot of people calling for more stories, which is great. And I'm glad they are. A lot of the big agencies are. But just telling your story doesn't help if you don't know how to tell your story. There's a lot of barriers and obstacles to telling your story. And we're going to address those as we go forward to help you tell yours and help break us all out of the Parkinson's prison. And there's one big thing that we're really well aware of, which is apathy. I want to, but I can't. Again, the Parkinson's prison. If you understand what that is, again, you know what that feels like. You know how it can shut you down. I want to call forward another one of our students right now, and this is Ben BJ Bement to read his piece for us, and I'll stop to share so we can bring him forward and spotlight him. BJ, like Doris, has been with us for a little while, and as well as doing the Day One program, has been doing some of the improvisation work we'll talk about. BJ, you ready?
Yes, sir. All right. Parkinson's disease is a thing that goes bump in the night. I can't always see its physical effects, but I can always feel it there, lurking. I will not be scared, cowed, or cornered by this disease. I will continue to live as a survivor and not one being knocked down or taken prisoner. I've been on a journey for the past few months to understand and reshape my relationship with Parkinson's. This class permeates my dark feelings and frustrations and bubbles them up to the surface. There they bob on the surface to be plucked out one by one and dealt with. I've learned that I don't have to keep the dark side covered. I can expose it to the light and see it shrivel away. Storytelling matters because we are hardwired to learn from each other. Our stories give us power, agency, and the ability to connect. Parkinson's has a terrible way of imprisoning not just our bodies, but our minds. So many of us hide what we are thinking and feeling because we don't want to be seen as weak. We have the potential still to be great and contribute. We don't want to carry the shroud of anyone's pity. Today's the day we declare it's not okay to pretend Parkinson's isn't that bad. It is that bad, and we can end it if we act together, learning what our stories are and being brave enough to share them.
All right, give it up for BJ being brave enough to share that right there. Anything you hear or feel, by the way, along the way from especially our contributors, Doris, BJ, others you're going to hear, please, if you have a favorite quote or a favorite line, put that into the chat, something that made you feel something. This is interactive and it means something, I know, to them too, to know they're being heard. It can be even, I hear you, I feel that, I notice. Any of those statements are really important. So thank you, everybody, for continuing to offer what you feel and think as we share these stories that help shape what we want to see Parkinson's as, knowing that the goal is to end Parkinson's disease. Now, within this space, you've heard us talk a little about a heroic journey. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to bring forward what the hero's journey looks like in terms of a map, because if you're going to get somewhere, you better have a map to know how to get there. This is this 12-piece look at the hero's journey as provided by a person that you guys may know, Joseph Campbell. Now, this is actually an adaptation of his work by another writer named Christopher Vogler in more of a screenwriting sense. I have a background as a filmmaker, and so that plays into what we're doing here. We're looking at mythic structure in a classic form that we normally see it, usually in Hollywood movies or TV shows. So what we do is we begin in the ordinary world and we progress our way around the circle. There's a call to adventure, which in our case is the diagnosis of Parkinson's, a refusal of the call, which many people face because they either try to hide or deny it. Now, that's not everybody, but it's a common stage. By understanding I've got to do something about this, we open up an ability to meet a mentor, somebody who helps us. And at that place, we leave behind the ordinary world, the life before Parkinson's, and cross the threshold into the special world, where now we're going to see and feel things differently. There'll be tests and allies and enemies, and then the approach to the inmost cave. And you heard Doris's writing about that there, where we feel the biggest wish and the biggest fear juxtaposed against each other. Then we go into the ordeal where we face that thing in the cave or the dark place, the thing that we were most afraid of. We're somehow victorious and come out the other side and we get something for it. That's the reward. And now it's time to head back to the ordinary world because we know whatever we gained wasn't for us. It was for the people we're trying to help. It could be our family, our friends, the Parkinson's community at large. It's not going to be easy, though, because whatever we battle down here is not happy. And that could be a piece of ourselves. We make our way back into the resurrection where something is going to die, a belief system, something that was no longer necessary or needed for the new life we want to have. And when we return with the elixir, that thing to be healed, the world, ordinary world, is forever changed. Now, we also use a very popular movie called The Shawshank Redemption. Go ahead and put it in the chat. If you like The Shawshank Redemption, say yes, put Andy, put Red, put anything that's your favorite in the chat, because The Shawshank Redemption is a classic hero's journey structure. And we are able to, in this class, break down Andy Dufresne's heroic journey and his effect on the prison, which fits our Parkinson's prison motif. And so that's something we do in this class. Now, one of our writers, Perry, I want to welcome him right now, writes about his own journey at this point and how he was able to bring some of these elements to the table. He's gone through a tremendous change because I know Perry, when he started and I met him, he was pretty sure he knew what his story was. And as he's developed in this class, he's had a lot of transformative thoughts, and I'm looking forward to hearing from him. Perry, take it away, my friend.
Parkinson's disease is an invisible and dangerous thief. Personality and functional abilities are taken from you as you watch it happen, and you've not a clue as to why or how. It's also the fastest growing neurological disease in the world, and according to the authors of Ending Parkinson's Disease, a pandemic. For those who know me, it's a question of which Perry are they seeing today? In my own mind, it's on, off, or trying to appear fine, hoping that my feelings are not displayed in an open window for others to see the confusion and fear within. This can't be me, but it is, as it is also for a million like me, each with a unique experience that needs to be shouted out to fully understand the reason this terrible disease must be stopped in its tracks now, today. I've been on a journey for the past few months to understand and reshape my relationship with PD. This class is teaching me how to transfer emotion to paper, having the reader feel what it's like to daily negotiate the countless faces of PD and the toll they exact. I've learned through my own journey that bringing awareness to the fact that more and more people will fall victim is imperative. Storytelling matters because we are hardwired to learn from each other. Our stories give us power, agency, and the ability to connect. Parkinson's has a terrible way of imprisoning not just our bodies, but our minds. PD is infinitely more than a tremble or a shuffling gait. There's nothing as frustrating as hearing you look fine when it takes everything inside of you to look that way, knowing that the moment you get home, the invisible parts of this disease will retake their prisoner. Today's the day we declare it's not okay to pretend PD isn't that bad. It is that bad. And we can end it if we act together, learning what our stories are and being brave enough to share them.
All right, give it up for Perry. Beautifully done, Perry. And I think what you're hearing thematically is from all of our storytellers, that idea of the hidden side of Parkinson's, the isolated, the Parkinson's prison, as it were, the face we put on the outside to make it look like it's not that bad, maybe for acceptance, maybe out of fear, stigma, any of those things. All of those things take a toll, however, because they take so much energy to do, and then people don't see, as Doris and Perry and BJ have talked about, what it actually feels like on the other side. And they may, in fact, have a counterproductive effect because people go, well, you look fine. Well, there's more going on that isn't fine. And our stories help illuminate that. All right, let's keep rolling forward because we have more stories to tell and you guys are doing a great job. I've mentioned a few of these story mentors who light our path. And these are people we lean on to help us understand your story. We use a lot of different quotes and we mentioned the movies, of course. Joseph Campbell says, stories are in our DNA. He looked at stories from the beginning of time, the cave dwellers, through modern times, and he said, we're telling the basic same story no matter when or where we started. And that tells us that there is something we can do to connect if we tell our stories in the way that is connected to others. Brené Brown is a popular researcher and a social worker who says, just as you've heard a lot of our students talk about, we're hardwired, just what Joseph Campbell mentioned too, to connect. And by the way, our emotions matter a lot. So when we explore our feelings, which we'll talk a little more later about, that's where we find, oh, wait a minute, I may have been not telling myself the whole story, because we can fall victim to our own story, which says, it's not that bad. I'm going to convince myself it's not that bad so I don't have to deal with the truth, which, no punches pulled, can be difficult. Viktor Frankl, maybe you know who he is. He is the man who wrote Man's Search for Meaning, and he spent time in a Nazi prison war camp in the 1940s as a prisoner and was destined to die like so many people did. But he saw the difference in humanity when people had a purpose, and that meaning allowed them to continue. He said, if you know your why, you'll figure out your how. So what are we here for? So this purpose of telling our story and doing the impossible, this can help us get to how. Andy Dufresne, the lead in the Shawshank Redemption, told us all, get busy living. You could put the rest of that in the chat. I'm sure you know what the end of that is. But even with all that help and guidance, we need to come together and tell our own stories. Okay. So how do we do that? Well, we work together. We have a path to figure that out. I'm going to welcome our next storyteller up to the screen right now. And Russ Parker has why he came about. And again, another person who saw a transformation pretty large in this class. And I have heard you, Russ, say that you feel like this is an adaptive place for you where you are. Take it away, Russ.
Okay. Parkinson's disease is a carnival of wild rides and distractions. I've been bashed around in the bumper cars, got queasy on the spinning roundup, endured the distortions and scary unknowns in the funhouse, and felt the emotional and symptomatic ups and downs of the roller coaster. It's also, you may have heard, the fastest growing neurological disease in the world, according to the authors of Ending Parkinson's Disease. For those who know me, you know I refuse to let this disease own me. And I will relentlessly work to learn and do everything I can to live well with PD. And I'll do the best I can as an advocate to raise awareness for better quality of life for people with PD and push for a cure. It is now time to tell my story as I've never told it before. This class has taught me that while being relentless and positive is good, you can't face down a disease like Parkinson's by minimizing or denying the true impact it has on quality of life. The impact not only affects physical and mental well-being, but strains relationships, socially isolates, often demoralizes people into a state of apathy. I have learned from this class to dig deep into my feelings, discover myself, truly understand what I wish for, and to be honest with myself and with others. I learned to acknowledge my greatest fears and to confront them head on.
And here he is. Give it up for Russ, confronting that all right in front of us. And Russ, again, for all of you, so brave, so vulnerable in the definition of courage that we bring up our relationships and recognize Russ is a big exercise guy. And he told me early on, you know, he knew, yeah, I'm surface level storytelling. He saw me asking questions and he said, you're right. And it's caused some real positive changes in his relationships as he's learned to ask for help and learned to be better through expressing his story. Thank you and congratulations, Russ. That's really great stuff. Now, we mentioned, the writing we do is important, of course, individually. However, what I say to the students all the time is the most important writing you'll do is the writing you'll do, the feedback you leave on your fellow students' pages. So when we talk about feedback, specifically, we offer, I feel, I notice. It might even be me too. I see you. I feel what you're saying. These types of things offer encouragement because writing can be a lonely process. However, when we bring forward the stories, which we share every week, they write one page, and then we comment on each other's writing, we know that what we write matters. We know it was heard. We know it affected someone in our group. And if it affected someone in our group, there's a good chance it's going to affect someone else. So our participants, what they feel like when they give and receive it, they feel bigger, they feel stronger, they feel more powerful, they feel heard. All of these things are antithetical to being in the Parkinson's prison. The most important thing we do is we build this safe and brave space that we can make these things happen together. And it happens in these classes, which are all online in the same type of Zoom space. And one of our students who couldn't be here today, now we're going to hear her story read by another student who could be here today. Loretta wrote a piece that Susan Scarlett is going to read. And Susan, please take it away. Do we have Susan? I just want to make sure.
Is there, but Susan, you're muted.
Ah. That happens maybe 1,000 times in a Zoom meeting. There she is. Okay. Hey, first of all, give it up for the hat. I mean, come on. All right, Susan, please read Loretta's letter.
Dear people who care about Parkinson's disease, do not misunderstand the brevity of this letter with the intensity of my feelings about this course, day one, Parkinson's prison and the hero's journey to escape. If I don't like to write, why didn't I sign up for a writing course? Since Parkinson's is beginning to silence my speech, I need to develop other ways of communicating. It was the perfect writing course for me. The anchors were very simple. Don't be boring or confusing. And use lots of metaphors. And oh, by the way, everyone in the course has a significant connection to Parkinson's disease, which I've had for 15 years. This course introduced me to the power of metaphor. Rocky road ice cream becomes rocks and potholes. Hallways become PD diagnostic tools. The Japanese garden becomes characters in my drama. A school becomes a tree. I loved thinking about metaphors. As a visual learner, they helped me understand and express feelings I didn't realize I had. Through reading my classmates' writings and seeing them on a small Zoom screen, I appreciate how each of us are affected differently by PD, and yet we're all on the same journey.
Give it up for Susan reading Loretta Byer's piece. Absolutely beautiful. Thank you so much, Susan. And what you heard Loretta write about and Susan therefore speak about was metaphor. Metaphors can be really tricky, right? On the outside, or you could think, I don't know what they mean or how to put them forward. They also are incredibly powerful to open our minds, because one thing we really work on here is we don't, or play with too, I should say, our work is play. We allow ourselves to become bigger than the literal. If we're going to defeat the impossible, in fact, we have to delve into mythology, which means making ourselves larger than either we or others know us as. So there's a concept called mythologizing yourself. And what does that mean? Well, when you're imprisoned in the literal, this is who I am, and this is all of who I am, we're going to escape using metaphor and myth to see things in a different frame so we can express that inside thing. Because one of the problems in Parkinson's is we know about the physical symptoms, right? The neurologists and the movement disorder specialists who are brilliant at what they do, that's what they focus on. And that tends to be what people define Parkinson's as. What we, the people with Parkinson's or dealing with loved ones who have it, know is the psychosocial side is at least as big, if not a bigger component of Parkinson's, and it's not well dealt with. So why mythologize yourself? Because you feel stuck, that the literal self, you can only see this. You can't see beyond where you are, that this is all there is apparently, and maybe you feel yourself sliding. And that again, it feels impossible, whatever it is you're trying to do. So here's a couple of quotes that other people we look at that help us see ourselves in a larger way. The antagonist, of course, is the person that chases us. And sometimes it's us chasing us. It's us as our own shadow. Robert McKee says a protagonist and his or her or their story can only be as intellectually fascinating and emotionally compelling as the forces of antagonism make them. So we have to take something or someone on. And sometimes that is us. There's another one here by Jim Collins, which is really fun. He says, get a BHAG, a big, hairy, audacious goal. And that's what we talk about when we're talking about getting a cure for Parkinson's by telling stories. Yeah, it's impossible. Does that mean we shouldn't do it? Absolutely not. We're going to prove the impossible to be possible by attaching ourselves to something larger than us. In this case, the Ending Parkinson's Disease authors have told us they need stories. Hey, we've got stories. We just need to tell them in a way that matters. And that means engaging the audacity of wishes. We have to wish for something really big. And we're going to shift our focus from defending what we have to imagining what we need using our creativity. But again, what if it's impossible? Well, remember Aaron Brockovich, remember Big Tobacco, and remember the Mothers Against Drunk Driving. Those were impossible, and they all happened. And again, you can't see an opportunity until you're willing to look for one. That's what Tad Washington, another doctor, tells us in a paper titled Mythologizing Yourself. Now, this is a discussion for the group, but I'm going to hold off, and it's because I want to make sure to get our next two writers in. Something to think about, though, and you can chat about it if you'd like, and either the people who are in our course or anybody. The question is, how has allowing yourself to wish and accepting your heroic potential helped you get the most out of your abilities, which we sometimes hide from ourselves and others? So if you're feeling that and you want to put that in the chat right now, you know, allowing yourself to wish and accepting your heroic potential, does it make you bigger, better, do more? Go ahead and chat about that if you like. I'm going to move forward so I make sure to get in all of our writers. Now, I mentioned emotions earlier today. There's a wheel of emotions, okay? And in our improvisation games, we often play this wheel of emotions and we chant, I don't know, as it spins, because none of us truly know what emotions are going to pop up at various times during the day. We do have the ability to choose how we wish to react to those, and we can train ourselves to once again not be hijacked by them when we explore or play with them. Now, Bernays Brown research, she's gone ahead and she's looked at emotions over the last 20 plus years, and she's found out some interesting things. She says, we cannot selectively numb emotions. When we numb the painful emotions, we also numb the positive emotions. So that sounds like a prison, right? I'm not going to feel the pain, the fear, the anything that limits me or feels scary. I'm not going to feel those. By doing that, we necessarily limit our joy, our expressive curiosity, any of those things that we might want to get, they're lessened equally. So what do? Well, we have to play and explore. In one of her research pieces, she interviewed 7,000 people. And you know what the average number of emotions identified were for those 7,000 people? Put it in the chat, those who know, I'll put it up here. 3. The average person said in those 7,000 interviews that there was happy, sad, and as Brené says, pissed off. Those were the 3 emotions. Can you imagine how limited your life would be if those were the only emotions you were allowed to feel? And yet many people couldn't identify more than that. So what we want to do is we want to take and feel our fears and put them right out and be vulnerable as we do with our writing. And we put them right next to our wish. And we recognize this is impossible. How can we have this wish and this fear next to each other? And we allow those things to go to battle. And in that comes a new way of thinking, something that allows us to progress. And when we face those greatest fears, we get a reward. And right now, one of the rewards we're going to get is Wayne, who's going to read to us a piece from his Road Back. So Wayne, why don't you go ahead and give us that piece you wrote? Thank you.
Hello there. Before PD, I would describe my life as overall happy, even joyous. My religious beliefs helped me work through the grief of losing family members and other difficult times in my life. And I also learned to work at forgiveness in my life. But I was forced into another world the day I was told I had Parkinson's. Driving home from the doctor that day, my mind was filled with many dark thoughts about how my life, as I knew it, was over. My wife's life would be greatly affected also. I felt like crying. My PD first appeared as an iceberg. I started out only looking at the tip. I was not prepared for the totality of how it was going to affect my daily life. An early sign was my inability to open jars. Simple issue, right? However, I lost a status symbol that I never realized I had had. I was no longer the family jar opener. Of course, it wasn't about the jar. It was the reminder to both me and the family of my weakness. We installed a gadget under the cabinet that allowed everyone to open jars. So now I'm replaced by a gadget. The next ego crusher occurred during a college football game that I went to with my grandson. He was in high school at the time. During the national anthem, I started crying. My grandson looked at me with total disbelief and worry, and he asked what was wrong. With a strangled and cracked voice, I squeaked nothing. I shall forever remember, though, how embarrassed and humiliated I felt. As the iceberg exposes more of itself in my world gets smaller and smaller. Is it fear or is it just anger? Anger at having the fastest growing neurological disease in the world, and the world doesn't seem to notice. When I tell people I have PD, I frequently hear, "You're lucky. Most people live a long time with that." What? I'm lucky? Winning the lottery is lucky. Having Parkinson's just sucks. I am now a forced host to a disease that alters not only my physical abilities, but also my mental health. My madness finds me constantly looking for things to laugh at, including myself, because that brings joy to me and provides relief from my despair. Parkinson's hasn't found a way yet either to take that away from me. I'm forced to graciously accept help doing things that I no longer can do for myself. Accepting help is a learned skill. What I need is for the government to provide funding and find a cure. that would give us all the hope that we now deserve. During the pandemic, the government gave two large drug companies over $1 billion each. They developed two different vaccines in just a few months. When was the last time you heard someone talking about the federal government providing money for Parkinson's research? Damn the dark. Damn this disease.
Give it up and give a big hug to Wayne for beautifully telling his story and sharing his whole heart with us. And by the way, if you notice in the background, the most interesting man in the world, the guy in the foreground is actually the most interesting man in the world. Wayne, that is so beautiful, and thank you. And what I want to really point out again is the power of the voice, okay, that comes forward, the demand for these things, to say it's not okay, to see these silent things can no longer stay silent, that we need to come forward and say what we need with love, with hope, with honesty. We're running short on time, so I'm going to go ahead and get one more up here to make sure I have another story to share right now. I'll go through the slide really quickly. Benicia is going to be up next, but here's what we have to say. There's challenges to telling stories that make an impact, okay? Some of the barriers include, but writing is work. Hey, no doubt it is. We talk about breaking down to pieces that hopefully make it more palatable. You may have had trauma. You're a bad writer. Maybe you've had a bad teacher. We again get past that. We don't worry about grammar, spelling, punctuation in this class. We worry about your heart, your feelings, your emotions, your lack of skill. I don't write. Well, we practice in ways that hopefully make it again more possible for you. A lot of people with Parkinson's use text to talk too, and that's another way around, or they get people to help them write. All of that works. What is my story? Well, that's again what we explore within our group. And then who would care? Well, I hope you're seeing within this group today who would care. It's all of you. And I certainly know our good friends at PMD Alliance care, because we struck up a partnership about where these stories might end up as we build them. And then the fear of vulnerability. If I say what I really think, well, I hope you've seen what that looks like today. It looks like courage, because every single one of our writers has been vulnerable and brought something amazing to the screen. And I want to bring another one right now. And this is Benicia Bradfield, and her story. Let's go ahead and bring her to the screen so she can share her story. Hi, Benicia.
Parkinson's disease is a viper fish that prowls through my brain, attacking my neurons and depleting me of much needed dopamine. It's also the fastest growing neurological disease in the world, and according to the authors of Ending Parkinson's Disease, a pandemic. For those of you who know me, you know that I may have Parkinson's, but Parkinson doesn't have me. This class has shown me that I may not be able to control what happens to me, but I can control my attitude and how I choose to respond to the daily onslaught of symptoms. I discovered that I have kept myself in a prison of my own making, a Parkinson's prison of fear of freezing, of falling, and of the future. I resent having to constantly be aware of when and how I move through space so that I don't fall. I hate having to take meds every 5 hours. I despise passing mirrors and trying to remember to ditch the mad phase. Through the cathartic writing of my individual story, I've come away with the courage to fight back. Storytelling matters because we are hardwired to learn from each other, and our stories give us power, agency, and ability to connect. Together, we will find a cure.
You betcha, Venetia. Well done. Thank you so much for that. Now, one thing I want to highlight, because you may not hear it completely in the stories you're hearing today, but it's a big part of what we do. We do laugh a lot. We use improvisation, and I don't have a lot of time to go over that right now, but I want to offer that to all of you to say that we play every Tuesday at 10 a.m., and you can find it on our website, yesandexercise.org, and every Thursday at 4 p.m. Those times are Pacific. And we come together to play, to learn how to trust the unknown and learn to laugh together, to remember what it feels like to feel good, to literally, as we call it, jam for joy together. That's what we do. So I'm just going to bring up this last slide just to basically show all of you who we are and what we have, so that we can all get the call to action today, which is to get you all to sign up and take part in the next round of what it is we're doing together. Here it is. Our call to action is freedom. Right back to the top. What we want, we're raising our voices for the cure today. We're looking for writers and supporters. So if you you want to be a writer, yes, please sign up. And you can do that through our website. If you want to support those, some people can't afford the tuition. There is a tuition for this class because it's a long time. We go 16 weeks together, one class per week for 90 minutes. And we do a lot of writing together. So there is a tuition. So if you could support someone else, maybe you're not up to writing right now, but you could support someone who couldn't afford the tuition, we could certainly use your help too. We're starting on August 21. That's just 10 days from now, a week from Monday. There's the website, and you click on day one and you'll get everything you need. And there is my email, which is also available through the website to get you everything you need. Take a screenshot, because I'm going to stop sharing and bring us all back to seeing each other, because there's too many great faces not to see right now. And there we go. I'm back. Okay, everybody. I know we've got just a couple minutes. Is there anything, Andrea, I can do to, is there any pressing, burning questions that you see in the chat or anybody who's dying to say something?
There were some beautiful messages of support and hell yeah, exclamation mark. I didn't see any questions other than how do I sign up? And you just addressed that. But perhaps we were all, you know, being present and listening. So I invite everyone, if you have questions, if you want to, now is your chance. And thanks, Robert, for providing the website and the email. And as I mentioned again in the chat, I bet this is going to be a popular one to watch on the recording. So that'll be up on our YouTube and our website next week. And yes, actually, we do have a comment from Miss Kelly from Texas. So please take it away, friend.
I'm the oddity here today. And my health's been down is the reason I'm not more involved today. But Robert and all these day wonders here are my support and my strength as a caregiver in this journey. Without them, I could not have made it. And so this is just not for those with Parkinson's. This can support care partners and caregivers in ways you will never know. So all those out there that are the carers, consider this. Come see how it can change your life also.
We love you, Kelly. Thank you so much. Yeah, that's beautiful. And to that end, I haven't seen it, but I did get contacted by I believe it was a son with his mother who had Parkinson's. You could come together. Yeah, absolutely. For a single tuition, of course, the two of you could write the story together, or even you both write your story, but you come together. Yeah, we could do that. You come play for sure. Because as a care partner myself, I understand, or a caregiver, your preferred term is welcome, however you wish to identify in that regard. This is for everybody. Good. Was there anybody else question-wise or comment-wise and wanted to make sure to say hi? And I see Shabir writing, who's also a day oneer, and he has some stories to be tell, which he'll be putting out there. You heard, I want to note from Susan earlier, if you want to hear more about her transformation to becoming this extraordinary version of Susan Scarlett, go to the Daily Dose of Dopamine, which is a webcast. She is co-founder of the website, her and I do together. And she'll tell you about, you can see the video recording of her journey to becoming this extraordinary version of herself.
Wonderful. Well, what an amazing 60 minutes together. Thank you, Robert. Thank you, everyone who shared. Thank you, everyone who was present and listening. And we always like to close out with a moment of gratitude, a wave of gratitude. And there's a lot of us with smiling faces. So scroll through, see all of the smiling boxes, and we're in it together. We're here. And it was just a wonderful time together. So thanks, Robert, and thanks everyone who joined.
Thank you, Andrea. It was wonderful. Thank you for having me.